Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage SC15 General Chair Jackie Kern.
Welcome to Austin and SC15. For this year's plenary, we are thrilled to have one of the leading industry voices in HPC innovation joining us this evening. Diane Bryant is a Senior Vice President and General Manager of Intel Corporation's Data Center Group. The technologies Diane's group delivers are used by researchers in a wide range of advanced modeling tasks, including ones that simulate how heart valve tissue responds to blood flow and how genes and proteins affect Alzheimer's. Before leading the Data Center Group, Diane was Intel's Chief Information Officer, where she was responsible for driving Intel's own IT infrastructure and software, supporting product design, manufacturing, and a variety of business functions. Diane has been with Intel since 1985, when she started as a design engineer, and she holds 4 U.S. patents. She is a strong advocate for women in technology, and this year earned a spot in Fortune's list of most powerful women in business. Please join me in welcoming Diane to the stage. Okay. So good evening, everyone. I am very pleased to be here with you this evening to kick off the 27th anniversary of SC. It is wonderful to have this opportunity to talk to you about my perspective on high-performance computing and the transformations ahead. So the traditional scientific methods of theory and experiment were forever transformed by HPC and scientific simulation. Arguably, the last time science was so radically changed was over 400 years ago when Galileo invented the telescope and extended the range of the visual observation beyond the unaided eye. Scientific computing did something quite similar. So extending the range of exploration beyond the intuitive and analytical processing capability of the human brain. With HPC, we can now see things that just a decade ago we couldn't possibly imagine. So as an engineer at Intel, I first became involved in high-performance computing in 1998, when I was directed by our then CEO to leave my job managing the mobile computing engineering group and to go fix Itanium. And yes, I got that mandate. And so I have to say, it was very exciting for all of us when the first Itanium system hit the top 500 list at number 34 in 2001 with the National Center for Supercomputing Applications. And then even more exciting for me was when Itanium 2 made it to number 2 spot in 2004, thanks to Lawrence Livermore National Labs. So you fast forward now a decade, and we see the impact of high-performance computing everywhere. You see it in healthcare. The combination of big data and HPC gives tremendous promise. Genome sequencing is opening up new windows into the causes and cures and treatments for diseases that are discoverable through DNA, such as Parkinson's and Alzheimer's disease and cancer. And you look at how high-performance computing is slowly but surely reaching beyond the Fortune 500 and into medium-sized companies like BMI. So they're a design and engineering firm that was granted time on Oak Ridge National Labs' Jaguar supercomputer. And through simulation, they redesigned that classic semi-truck for greater aerodynamics, saving $19 billion annually in fuel costs. Significant. And then the classic scientific exploration continues. For example, the Stephen Hawking Center for Theoretical Cosmology, which houses obviously the Cosmos supercomputer. Their work has provided previously unimaginable information about how the universe and the bodies within it were formed. And just moments ago, we're happy to say HP Wire recognized the Stephen Hawking Institute and Intel for MODL, which was our joint effort in modernizing the code. It's an effort that received the Reader's Choice Award for Best Use of High Performance Data Analytics. So we're very proud of that. We're very, very proud. So the decades of innovation from the industry and the resulting performance improvements and energy efficient performance improvements that have been delivered is incredibly impressive. The community of engineers, of developers, of system architects have continued to just redefine the boundaries of technology and drive innovation through every aspect of high-performance computing. And the result is HPC's fundamental recursion. As HPC transforms the science transforms HPC, and it propels us forward. And there's no better example of this than Gordon Moore's insights 50 years ago that transistors would continue to advance in performance while delivering lower cost through scaling. Beyond making that observation, which then became known as Moore's Law, Gordon was also the visionary that got Intel into the HPC community. And so in preparing for today's event, I thought, what the heck, I'll give Gordon a call. So I called Gordon, and he's retiring in a very nice home in Hawaii, but he was very happy to chat, and I want to share with you his thoughts that he wanted to share with you on high-performance computing, both the past and the future.
We always had some interest in the supercomputing end of things, and our first real expedition into it was with Caltech and the hypercube architecture they had developed that eventually became the Touchstone Delta.
It represents successful cooperation between government, academia, and industry.
Everybody was sure there were applications just waiting to take advantage of the performance. And as the performance increases, the range of problems that could be addressed continues to grow. I could see the performance was going to continue to increase for quite a while. And amazing to me that we still are able to make the advances in performance from one generation to the next. There are a myriad of places where better models will improve our ability to do things. We're generating huge data sets in a lot of different areas, and it requires capability of supercomputers to really handle them. This really enables a third way of doing science. For years, we had to look at experiments and theories, but the theories could only handle relatively simple cases. But with the advent of high-performance computing now, very much more complex problems can be tackled in a useful way. I look at some of the things that have been, for example, modeling the formation of galaxies. These are things that just couldn't have been done without the high-performance computing capability. And I think we're going to find things like that across most of the areas of science.
And so the recursion in HPC starts at the most basic levels, technology itself. So around the turn of the century, predictive simulation capability emerged, and giving us then the ability to identify where theory and experimentation may have actually gotten it wrong. And ASCII Red was Intel's first supercomputer, and it broke all records and ushered in the world of the teraflop regime. And Justin Ratner, who actually is sitting right here in the front row, was at the time director of technology at Intel, responsible for achieving the teraflop challenge. Congratulations on having done that. And also sitting with him is Paul Messina. Thank you for being with us as well. So you fast forward to today, and you have Tianhe 2, the fastest supercomputer. It's running with our current Xeon Phi processor, Knight's Corner. The current number one supercomputer is now 25,000 times the performance of that Pentium Pro-based ASCII Red, and at only 20x the power. So you look forward now to our next generation of Xeon Phi, which is Knight's Landing. And Knight's Landing will deliver the performance of at least 15,000 Pentium Pros. And I say at least because we haven't actually announced what the peak performance of Knight Landing will be, and I know there's a lot of mathematicians out here that are gonna calculate quite rapidly and figure it out. So, but it is more than two ASCII Red supercomputers in this single chip. And that's thanks to the economic model of Moore's Law. Knight's Landing and the processors on the near horizon are going to be delivering cost per terabyte of less than $1,500. That's compared to over $13 million per teraflop in the era of ASCII Red. So it's a great view into how technology has transformed HPC. And as this recursive process would dictate, HPC is also transforming technology, and at that very foundation, Moore's Law. And here to talk about the transformation is Mark Bohr. Mark Bohr is Intel's senior fellow. He's in the process technology development team, and we count on him for keeping Moore's Law alive. He's currently working on 5 nanometers. So Mark, why don't you come on out? He's going to appear. There he is. How are you? So, let's see here. Get ourselves straight. So anyway, based on the dependency between HPC and Moore's Law, the biggest worry has got to be that all these naysayers are actually right and Moore's Law is dead or dying. So how do you answer those skeptics?
Absolutely not true. You know, we continue to scale transistors, and each generation provides transistors that are higher performance, consume less active power, and, of course, cost less per transistor.
And it's going on and on and on.
And it's going on
5 nanometers now. So now that you're on to 5 nanometers, you have to tell us what are the biggest technical challenges that you're faced with. What are the hurdles?
Well, one key challenge we have is trying to pattern a 10-nanometer or 7-nanometer dimensions using lithography tools that use a wavelength of light of 193 nanometers. So you need some
challenge.
Pretty special tricks to do that. Another example of our challenge is that when we manufacture these scaled transistors and interconnects, some of the thin films that we use are only a few atoms thick. So this is pretty challenging.
Those are pretty challenging, yes, that's impressive. So how then does HPC, if you can give us some insight to how Intel uses HPC to actually address these challenges?
So one good example of how we use high-performance computing to help us extend Moore's Law is the amount of computing power it takes to make a photomask, the photomasks that we use to pattern these integrated circuits. And some of our more critical photomasks today use over 1 million CPU hours to generate. That's the price we have to pay, again, to pattern 10-nanometer dimensions using 193-nanometer light.
Yeah, and within our own IT organization, we're quite proud of the fact that we now have on the June 2015 supercomputing list, we were number 81 with an 833 teraflop supercomputer. It dropped a little this morning after the next list, but still a darn good supercomputer. And it is developed and run in Intel IT to address exactly the challenges that you have. I think we have a photo here. Oh, there you go.
So this is an interesting graph. The blue line shows how over this period of time we have significantly increased the computing power in our data center by more than 50x. The yellow line shows how significantly we've improved the reliability. So the failure rate has just dropped like a rock in the early part of this period.
Yeah, when moving from the pre-HPC days in 2005, the old-fashioned days, into using HPC to solve the real tough problems. So as you look to the future then, what role do you see for HPC within Intel, and how much more capability and capacity are you needing?
So good. Right now, our research group is exploring a wide range of future device options using different materials, different structures to provide the needs of future computers. And it's impossible to do all that work, all that advanced research work, just with lab experiments. We depend very heavily on the use of modeling and simulations to do this. Otherwise, it would take us much longer and we would go down a lot of dead ends. But again, with HPC, with modeling and simulations, they are used to guide us to the better solutions.
That's great. It's insightful. Thank you, Mark. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Diane.
Yep, we'll see you later. Thank you. So as noted, around the turn of the century, with teraflop performance becoming a reality, simulation-driven science was enabled, bringing in a whole new era of possibilities. You fast forward to today, and arguably the most talked about application for HPC is machine learning. So we are rapidly reaching this tipping point stage where data is the game changer, which places HPC in a whole new realm of possibilities. HPC is fundamentally required to train these complex machine learning models. Without HPC, those models would remain useless in practice. So HPC is ushered in our ability to predict future events by leveraging intense compute power running on massive data sets. And then in turn, HPC is being transformed by machine learning. So the classical HPC approach of simulation-driven science is now being transformed into data model-driven science. So this is allowing now HPC to reach into sectors that have been previously untouched by HPC, such as agriculture or education or transportation. Each of these today are human-led services. They can now be transformed into machine intelligence-led services. And the hyperscale cloud service providers are leading the pack in driving broad access to machine learning. Baidu, the fifth largest cloud service provider worldwide, and obviously providing search to China, their chief scientist of Baidu Research, Andrew Ng, is a leader in machine learning and its practical applications. And he'd like to share with you his thoughts. So let's take a look.
Machine learning is a technology that lets computers get smarter and smarter all by itself just by looking at data. Every time you open your email, your spam filter saves you from reading spam. Every time you use a credit card and a piece of software checks if it's you or if someone's stolen your credit card. Or every time you use a web search engine, that's machine learning. Today is driving tremendous economic and social and user value, and it's getting better and better all the time. A few examples. I think that computational medicine is poised to make leaps and bounds in the next few years. I think that speech recognition, which sounds like a narrow technology, but if you can talk to your cell phone and have it work reliably, have it always understand you, that would transform the way all of us interact with our devices. Creative researchers and engineers are finding so many different ways to apply learning algorithms in so many different problems. It's almost hard to predict the future impact. I'm excited about the potential of technology to help the sight impaired. AI technology has gotten to the point where we can start to build wearable cameras, wearable devices like this that you can wear in your ear. And this AI learning algorithm powered by HPC can see what's in front of me and describe it in words to me via the little speaker that I'm wearing in my ear. A few centuries ago, the Industrial Revolution relieved all of humanity of a lot of physical drudgery. I think there is a potential in the coming decades for machine learning to relieve humanity of a lot of mental drudgery. That will free up so much human time to pursue higher endeavors. A lot of the progress in machine learning has been driven by the availability of bigger and bigger and bigger data sets. And coming with bigger data sets comes an insatiable hunger for more computational power to process those data sets. This is why leading technology companies are making more and more investments in HPC and supercomputers, and I think that HPC scientists could be the future heroes of the entire field of AI.
So over the years, So over the years, the reach of HPC has continually been extended. HPC has gone well beyond their traditional communities of scientists and researchers. The democratization of HPC is clearly occurring. One community that is being transformed by HPC is the makers. There's approximately 135 million makers in the US alone. That's over half of the adult population. And it's evident by the massive number of maker fairs and maker spaces and other hubs that span the nation. And it's a rapidly growing community with some significant economic might. In fact, the makers movement annually contributes $29 billion to the US economy annually. So they are enabled by HPC. Access to optimized infrastructure delivered through the cloud, whether it's public or vertical clouds. It's transforming the way the innovators are creating, collaborating, manufacturing, and reaching their customers. But today, only a small percent of the makers community leverages HPC tools to drive product development and prototyping. But the desire is massive. The desire for advanced compute platforms is very high amongst the community. The combination of HPC and the cloud is enabling the maker community to innovate outside the standard channels, enabling them to improve productivity, improve time to market, and materially reduce their overall R&D costs. And so I do believe that the maker community has the ability to transform HPC. The HPC market today, albeit very powerful, is still relatively small. It's less than 10% of all servers worldwide run in an HPC cluster. And the commercial use of HPC is still nascent. Today, less than 10% of the US manufacturers use HPC. So that shift from physical to digital for product modeling, prototyping, and simulation has yet to reach the tipping point. So you have to ask why. Well, the answer is complexity. It's still too hard to use, too hard to access. So the makers community, as a counterculture movement, can transform HPC. It'll force the installation of that easy button to access the computational power through new seamless workflows with expansive and secure collaboration capabilities. The makers, I believe, will influence and transform the HPC community. HPC is also transforming communities around the world and having impact at a national level. We see this. The world is chasing computational leadership. There is a growing recognition by governments that in order to compete at a global level, you've got to, and you want to raise the status, the domestic status of your nation, you have got to invest in compute. One recent and exciting example is India and their national supercomputing mission. And with me here today, I'm very happy to say, is Dr. Hemant Darbari. He came all the way from India to join us, and he's a founding member and the executive director of the Center for Development of Advanced Computing, or CDAC, which is an institution set up by the government of India to carry out advanced research in new and emerging technology domains. Dr. Darbari is a recipient of the Computer World Smithsonian Award Medal, as well as the Woswick Award for his contributions to the information and communication technology world. So, Dr. Darbari. It's a pleasure. Thank you for coming. I appreciate it. So let's start by explaining the role that CDAC plays in India's overall investment into high-performance computing. You can give us a little insight into what you're doing.
Yeah, India started its journey in HPC in 1988 and delivered first supercomputer, which was called Param, which was one gigaflop machine, in 1991. It continued to invest in HPC and deliver Param series of supercomputer. Today, we have several petascale machines in India. And looking to the future requirements of the government of India has sanctioned HPC, a project which is called NSM. The NSM addresses creation of next generation supercomputers, the petascale systems, which is going to be 100 petaflop type of range, total aggregated. Application development, skilled manpower development, and address the research towards exascale computing. CDAC is the nodal agency who is working onto this goal, and IISc, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, is also working with us.
It's a big undertaking. So sitting here in the U.S., we certainly see the worldwide investment that's being made in HPC. So as one of the countries that are making that big investment, maybe you can tell us a little bit of why it is so important to India, why you are investing at such a high level.
Yeah, India is strongly believing that innovation is going to be the need of the day. For example, 10,000 human lives were lost in 1999 cyclone in India. Last year, a similar intensity cyclone came, and the life loss was just 124. This was possible because of the accurate weather prediction using petascale systems. And early prediction helped disaster management and the team to move around 700,000 people out of the place. The fishermen were brought back from the sea, and that was a major success of HPC.
Major success.
Digital India is another area on which Government of India is giving a large push. And we are working on smart cities, smart governance, the IoT, the digital libraries, and all these things can really lead to success if we take the HPC on a right track. A successful knowledge economy, India is investing in training the manpower in a big way, and we are going to train tens of thousands of HPC skilled manpower. And that is why India matters. HPC matters a lot to India.
Yeah, so the how do you see then these, your Cyclone example was a compelling one, but how do you see these HPC investments overall then helping to solve some of the most difficult challenges that you face in India?
Yeah, I think that India is a agriculture-dominant country, and the economy depends on that. So the weather services to the farmers, the disaster management using HPC is one of the area. Then HPC, we have to design. A lot of simulation has to become. Now this simulation for the space launch vehicle, which has come up, for the moon mission or the Mars mission, when the prediction was done that when the exact time should be there, that param was used for that. So that is one area. Now the second major area is deep learning and HPC applied sciences, wherein the information extraction, the decision making, and the translation, which is going to be playing a major role in throughout the world because the communication becomes very important, the HPC is going to play a major role in there also. So we are working on to some projects in which the machine translation is done by the system, and one such system is running in the parliament with 95% accuracy. India cannot imagine life without HPC. And with the inroads in every sector, oil and gas exploration, space, health, life science, product design development, so those areas
very
we are
pervasive.
Going to be there.
Yeah, very pervasive. So then my last question is, you look to the future, what do you need in order to be successful? You've got a wonderful audience here of talent and expertise. What does India need in order to make this work?
Yeah, our first challenge is going to be the development of a scalable applications which can address India's specific problems. And efficient complete hardware and software integration and the environments which are required to be built, that is one. Then training the people to use this environment and take it to the next level. Similarly, the operational cost is going to be the major challenge because the mass deployment when we are talking of, we require that the operational cost of the system should be low and creation of human capital. That's what exactly we are looking forward to.
Lots of things you need. Well, so it's wonderful talking to you, and best to you on your journey. Thank you so
Thank
much
you.
For coming.
Thanks a lot.
So as you've heard, the transformation by HPC and the transformation of HPC is expansive, and the opportunities for impact is great. So let's look to the future now. What's needed to meet the future challenges? So first, we need to invest today in the thought leaders and the inventors of tomorrow. And in doing so, we need to ensure that the community is diverse, representing the expanded usages and the expanded users. So as an engineer in the computer world for 30 years now, I am thrilled to announce a new fellowship targeted at women and minorities with STEM undergraduate degrees. So Intel is committing to $300,000 per year for the next 5 years to fund fellowships for undergrads that are pursuing graduate degrees in computational and data science. When I joined Intel, Andy Grove, as you see there, he was our leader. He was Intel's third CEO. And I attribute my persistence as a minority in this field for those 30 years to Andy. As a survivor of the Holocaust, Andy, you know, endured what is the most extreme case of discrimination one can imagine. And the culture he created at Intel, I can't help but believe was influenced by that personal experience. It is a culture that values superior results with a complete blindness to the gender or religion or ethnicity of the person that actually created those results. And Intel has this wonderful system of meritocracy, a culture that I have found to be incredibly fair and certainly incredibly rewarding. Andy is also someone that is currently battling Parkinson's disease. And so Andy is passionate about the potential that HPC and data analytics can have on all aspects of business and society, but also healthcare. Andy is the one that in 2013, long after he had moved on to an Intel advisory role, he called me and very curtly asked me what I was doing to drive the use of big data analytics for Parkinson's research. And at that moment, I was not doing anything, but I can guarantee you that changed. We have been hard at work at this ever since. So in recognition of Andy's leadership at Intel, I'm thrilled to announce the ACM SIG HPC Intel Computational Data Science, Computational and Data Science Fellowship. And then we'll be working with the SIG HPC, we'll make this award available to students worldwide starting next year. And as an industry, by continuing this staggering pace of innovation, we propel ourselves into exascale computing. And I have a couple Intel fellows here with deep, rich expertise in this area. Al Guerra is an Intel fellow and chief architect for exascale systems at Intel. Prior to joining Intel, Al was the chief architect for all three of IBM's Blue Gene machines. And you may well know him for that. And with him is Mark Seeger. Mark is an Intel fellow and the chief technology officer for Intel's High Performance Computing Platforms Group. And Mark actually joined Intel after 28 years at the Lawrence Livermore National Labs, where he led advanced technology at the Livermore Computer Center. So Mark and Al, come on out. I knew you'd come. I knew you'd show up. There you go. Hey, we'll start with you, Mark. So give us your take on this worldwide investment that is occurring to reach exascale computing, and what is this investment going to get for all this?
It's a really good question, Diane. I like to think back to my experience in the ASCII program over the last 20 years, where we went from interpolative science to predictive simulation capability and built systems that were a million times more powerful in the process. That's absolutely astronomical, but we're not done. We have to get to exascale. We have to get another factor of 10 to the fifth computing capability, because we're at the dawn of the age of predictive simulation. We have to go through this journey to figure out where we can end up in this. There are so many opportunities today in predictive medicine to change people's lives, not here, but everywhere on the planet. And not for the rich, but for everyone. Democratize predictive simulation can democratize precision medicine for everyone. And there are global challenges that we're facing. Water shortages, wars are breaking out everywhere. And we have the global climate modeling challenge ahead of us as well. So we have vast problems that are demanding of this simulation capability.
Big, big challenges. Yep. So hey, Al, so what's taking us so long? So what are the technical limiters to getting to exascale?
I don't really think it's taken us that long. We've come.
Okay, you can have a raise this year.
We've come a long way. We have a long way to go, but we've come a long way. So this crowd is well aware that our biggest challenge right now is power, right? Power is so much of our focus when we architect systems, whether it's at the CPU level, the fabric level, whatever level it is. We've come a long way in our power efficiency, but the biggest challenges are ahead, right? As we can continue to scale the transistors, the energy efficiency is getting harder and harder to continue to scale. And so we need to get that through innovation. And so that's really one of the key challenges, but it's not the only one. So we have other challenges as well, right? We have to build systems that are usable. We can't build systems and just put more and more floating point units in there. They have to truly be usable. And so what I see happening is, as we go forward, I see that we really can address that by going to more of a sort of a specialized compute, where we start to include specialized compute in with our general purpose, in the end making an overall solution that has the attributes that we all know and love, but also allows us to push the envelope and really go for that exascale. And so that's what I see, and it's really exciting, because our attempt and where we're trying to go outpaces Moore's law. In reality, our performance improvements that we've had have almost approached 2x per year, which far outpaces Moore's law, and that's come through innovation. And so we just have to keep our foot on the gas and keep going.
So continue to invest in innovations around the vector of power, on heterogeneous computing.
Right.
It sounds like that's
all these areas are going to be really critical. And the other areas, I mean, it's all, it's in the end, it's a lot about cost, right? We can't just build machines that are only for a few. They have to be machines that are really affordable, and so really trying to drive the cost down is really one of the things that has enabled HPC to get to where it is really the cost improvement, the cost per performance is continuing to improve, and we obviously want to keep on that curve.
Hey, so I love talking about hardware, but there are some applications, right?
Yeah. Yeah, right.
So Mark, why don't you tell us about the application space? So what is it going to take advantage from an application side to take advantage of these new exascale solutions?
We have a two-track approach to application evolution and revolution. In the evolutionary mode, we think that we can produce a pretty big boost in performance with incremental changes to existing applications, taking that application base into the future. But the breathtaking new capability that Al was describing and 10 to the fifth improvement in performance, a new storage paradigm, all these breaking down the memory wall, breaking down the communication and IO wall will enable a completely new class of problems that we haven't even begun to think are possible. Again, back to my experience with the ASCII program, when we started out with interpretive science, we didn't really understand the depth of which predictive simulation would change the scientific method, which even Gordon Moore recognized. And so I think we'll see that kind of opportunity in a new generation of exascale applications.
Really impressive. So Al, at the high end, then the supercomputing market is obviously fascinating, and you kind of hit on this, that it would be great to see broader use, commercial applications. So where do you see exascale in the world of commercial deployments?
Well, I think, it already goes into a lot of the things that we do in exascale are applicable at all ranges of HPC. There are certainly some technologies that are really needed to get to the exascale, and that takes significant investment. But to get to the a lot of the technologies are really general, right? The focus on cost, the focus on general usability, all of the focuses I mentioned are things that are very applicable in power efficiency for all those. So I see that the effort that we're putting into exascale really will apply to the broader HPC ecosystem. And as we move towards more of even cloud type deployments, it really, those kind of capabilities and really being open up a new delivery mechanism to users really hopefully will continue to energize HPC and move it even to the next level.
Yeah, that's a good point. So Mark, we'll finish up with you then. So with this expanded access to exascale class systems, what does it mean for the broad user base?
The transformation at the broader HPC usage model, as Al was indicating, is equally breathtaking, because if we're successful in our goals to get to an exascale in the 2023 timeframe for about 20 megawatts in a system that's about 100 racks, means that in one-fifth of a rack, we'll have one petaflop at 20 kilowatts for several hundred K. And, that puts you into, the upper echelons of the top 500 list today. So imagine if, departmental investigators were able to have that type of computing at their fingertips.
Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it, how quickly that moves. So, Al and Mark, stay right here. And we all know that delivering continuous improvements in high-performance computing systems isn't easy and is only getting harder with each generation. So if we can advance the slide. There we go. So it does require breakthrough innovation across all domains, from compute to storage to fabric to systems to software to applications and beyond. So I want to introduce back to you Mark Bohr, senior fellow of our transistor technology. Come on out, Mark. Matt Adeletta. Oh, we get music. Matt Adeletta, senior fellow of the microprocessor architecture. We have Mark Seeger, Solutions Architecture, and Al Guerra, Systems Architecture. And then Bill Magro, our fellow from the Systems Software. And Pradeep Dubey, fellow of Applications. Hey, Pradeep. So these are Intel's most senior technical leaders in high-performance computing, and they're here at the event to meet you, hopefully debate with you, and collaborate with you. So Intel is invested and investing from transistors all the way out to applications. So from the societal impact, like solving complex diseases with data analytics, to the commercial impact with the democratization of high-performance computing, down to small businesses and the makers community, to the continued breakthrough in science and exploration. High-performance computing is transforming our lives, and with that comes the transformation of HPC. So thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage HPC Matters Chair, Wilf Penfold.
Once again, please join me in thanking Diane Bryant for such an inspiring presentation. So we're almost at the end here, but so this plenary session and the videos that introduced it are part of the HPC Matters campaign to highlight the extraordinary value that investments in advanced computational simulation and modeling bring to society, the economy, science, engineering, and education. Throughout the conference and into 2016, there will be opportunities for you to participate in social media, events, competitions, and competitions that continue this campaign. If you have compelling stories, please share them with us. We may be able to use them at next year's conference to highlight the HPC Matters campaign. For example, that today on the exhibit floor at the opening gala, we have the Impact Showcase, which will have presentations that highlight real-world applications that companies are using, where companies are using HPC to advance their competitive position and improve their innovation. We encourage you and your organizations to engage with us on this campaign. If you want to find out more about what's going on, there's a lot of social media engagement. You can find all the social media links on the website that's behind me, sc15supercomputing.org /media/social-media. Okay, so the ribbon cutting is pretty much directly below us on the ground floor outside Hall 3, which is right across from where the buses drop people off. In order to get there, best to leave here to my right, go to the elevator and go down to the ground floor. There'll be people down there who can direct you to that opening. And so with that, have a great conference. Thank you very much.